Hello everyone. Welcome to this wonderful session. I'm Dr. Pankil Dhruv, and on behalf of Prana, Adhisong, Hope, Dr. Shankaran's clinic, Adhisong, I welcome you all to this wonderful session. Just few instructions. Kindly don't interrupt anyone and speaker while the session is going on, so that smoothly it can happen. If you have any queries, you can put in the chat box and the speaker would be happy to address at the end of the session. The session would be approximately for an hour. And let's begin. So Dr. Devangsha, he is my dear friend, a senior consultant at the Song. He has an expertise in the polarity system. He went to Switzerland to understand, learn, and experience this method from Dr. Henner Frey. And we all are waiting to learn from your experience and to know more about this seminar. Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Devang.
To fight this situation. We had an impressive talk by Dr. Gaurang with some wonderful cases the other day. During my college days and early days of my practice, I used to attend many seminars of wonderful homeopaths, and I used to get inspired and wish to practice like them. As I started practicing, I started to face many difficulties, like for example, how to take a case, what questions to ask, how to form the totality, what is a peculiar in the case, which approach or repertory to use, what is the potency and repetition, and many more. These difficulties were not just for the acute illnesses, but also for chronic illnesses. Studying polarity analysis has helped me to answer these questions. It has given me the confidence to practice easy, simple homeopathy with consistent results, which is what I will be sharing with you all today. So let us begin with a case. Give me a second. Okay. So this is a case of a patient who was diagnosed with swine flu. On 14th of February 2019 in the afternoon, I get a call from a patient who is a firm believer of homeopathy. She says her sister is running temperature of 103 and 104 and is diagnosed with H1N1. The patient is already in the hospital and has taken all possible medications and things are going out of control. Her CT scan reveals multiple patchy areas of ill-defined peribronchovascular opacities with surrounding ground glass haze seen in the left lung. Some, they are coalescing and forming small areas of consolidation. Then we also see that the right upper lobe, lateral segment of the right middle lobe, posterior basal. So most of the right lobe is affected and there is bilateral pleural effusion with enlarged mediastinal lymph nodes. And the findings are suggestive of infective etiology. The treating physician advised her to take her to a bigger hospital. This caused panic in the family and my patient called me and asked if he can help her with homeopathy. Hearing this, I started to get palpitations, sweating of palms and trembling. This was more intense because the patient had more faith in me and I felt a sense of pressure to perform and live up to their expectations. This is generally what happens to us when we are dealing with an acute problem. A telephonic consultation was done with the patient on the same day. Her presenting complaint was cough and breathlessness. She had cough with salty expectoration. The symptoms that modified her problem were as follows. She was worse in a lying position. Walking a few steps or even talking for 10 to 15 minutes increased her breathlessness and coughing bouts. The only position that helped her was lying on the left side. Being in a cold room aggravated her problem. There was backache too, which was worse when she used to bend and better if someone presses the back. Since the problem started, she felt her appetite had gone down, her thirst had increased, and she became more irritable. These symptoms were repertorized using the therapeutic pocketbook. The approach used was Bonnie-Hosen's generalization, which my friend Dr. Gauran explained to you the other day. The software used is polarity analysis software by Dr. Heiner Freiser. So when we repertorize our complaints or the modalities and the associated concomitants, this is what we get. You see, there are 12 symptoms and there are 5 remedies which cover all the 12 symptoms, and out of which only one remedy is in white, whereas the others are in gray. So let me explain what is it. First of all, the symptoms below the blue line, that means the symptoms below this blue line, are the symptoms of the patient, and the symptoms below the red line are the polar symptoms, that is the opposite symptom. What do I mean? Patient says that she is better when she lies on the left side. That is the symptom of the patient. What is the polar symptom? The polar symptom is worse lying on the left side. Now this is done automatically by the software. We don't have to manually take one symptom, second symptom, second symptom, second symptom. Corresponding to each symptom, there are grades to the remedy. The grades which are below the blue line, they are in support of the remedy. That means these grades 3, 1, 4, 1, 2, 2, 4, 3, 2, 1, 4, 4 are in favor of Nurse Monica, whereas the grades which are below the red line are in opposition to Nurse Monica. For example, in this case, let us understand what is polarity difference. Polarity difference is the addition of the patient symptom. So you add this patient symptom, the polar symptoms. So you see here along the side of the each rubric there is written P. P means polar symptom. So you add all these symptoms, that will give you a particular count, and you have to minus the symptoms which are there below the red line. For example, in Nux Vomica, you have addition of patient's polar symptom, which is 28. The symptoms in the yellow here, they are non-polar symptoms, so we don't consider those into the addition. If you minus 12, which is the addition of the opposite symptoms, that is 4 plus 2 plus 1 plus 2, 2 plus 1 will give you 12. So 28 minus 12, you will get 16. So this is how the polarity difference is calculated, and again it is done automatically. The second aspect is the aspect of contradiction. So the remedies in the gray means the remedies are contraindicated. What does that mean? What is the contradiction of a remedy? Contradiction means when the grade of the rubric below the red line is more than the grade of the patient symptom, then the remedy is contraindicated. For example, you see our patient is worse when he is in lying position. How many marks Nux Vomica has here is 1 mark. But you see the polar symptom, that better by lying position. How many marks Nux Vomica has? It is 4. So 4 here is greater than 1. So whenever you have a grade which is more than what the patient symptom is, then the remedy is contraindicated. And that's how nuts, omega, calcarea carb, natrum carb, and sulfur are ruled out, and you are left with only remedy, which is Merck salt, and which is what we gave to the patient. What happens after Merck salt? After 2 days, they get an investigation done, and it is negative for H1N1. The patient says on the same day when she received the remedy, the cough was better by 50%, sleep improved. Next day morning, cough reduced, some backache persisted. After 2 days, no cough, no breathlessness, no backache. X-ray suggestive of mild pneumonitis from bilateral stool refusion and consolidation. And the H1N1 report completed. So by this way, things of managing acute become really very easy. Let me take you to another case. This is a case of a child, 8-year-old boy. The mother calls me at 6 a.m. in the morning. And she is in panic. And she says that my son has woken up with vomiting. And I assume that it could be simple indigestion, and advise him to keep him on light diet. She calls me again at 9 o'clock and she says that the pain has increased dramatically. So I ask her to bring him to the clinic, and I see him at around 11 a.m. And on examination, I find that the pain which was there in the umbilicus in the morning has shifted to the right iliac region with rebound tenderness. I asked her to get a sonography done immediately because clinically I suspected acute appendicitis. What were his symptoms? The pain was aggravated by pressure. In lying position, it used to get worse. Any form of movement used to aggravate the pain. Even on touch, it was worse. On rubbing, it was worse. When he used to bend, the pain increased. What gave relief was just sitting. The mother said that his thirst had increased and his appetite had reduced. Again, the symptoms were analyzed using therapeutic pocketbook and Bonnie-Hosen's grand generalization. And we get the following suggestion. You see, there are 10 remedies which cover all the symptoms, but 7 are eliminated due to the contraindication. So we are left with silica, Lidompal, arsenic has only 5, and cuprum, which is 12, polarity dose. Now, the general rule is to give the remedy which has the highest polarity difference. Normally, what I do is when I do such a kind of repertorization, I study the remedies which have high polarity difference. So I study 2-3 remedies. So in this case, the choice was between silica and Lidompal and maybe cuprum. Then, what I do is I go to Boric, Herring, Clark, Allen's Encyclopedia and refer a particular chapter in which the problem is present. And if the symptoms match, then I finalize the remedy. In this case, silica stands out clearly and hence it was given in 200 potency. The elimination remedy due to the contraindication is one of the finesses of the polarity analysis. This kind of elimination which you see is one of the biggest plus point when you are doing polarity analysis. Otherwise, what happens if you normally repertorize, you will get silica, mercury, calcarea, capsicum, pulsatilla, and then we are left in no man's land and you keep thinking which remedy to give. But this elimination helps us to only restrict ourselves to either silica or Lidompal. Mother sends her sonography report, and you see here it says that the findings are suggestive of mild acute appendicitis. So in the clinic itself, I give him one dose of silica 200. The mother messages me around 5:30, 5:45 in the evening, and she says that the pain is less. He had one toast, after the drop is okay, what do you advise next? I said, just wait, don't repeat the drop. Inform in 3 hours, eating is a good sign. Then she asked me, do you think he needs surgery? I said, no. He is looking good now. I said, that's good to know. And what happens next day? Next day morning, he is okay, slept well, had breakfast. What is the next course of action? Continue same medicine. If anything message, do you think he needs antibiotics or swelling? How will it go? The swelling will reduce. Everything will be fine. Then the same day, that is day 2 at night, he has no pain at all. He is playing. He is demanding all wrong food. I just give you 4 pills in the morning. What next? Just regular medicines to continue. And then on the 3rd day, he is good, no pain. I will send my driver to collect the medicine. And we repeat the sonography again. See, the sonography says that there is no definite sign of appendicitis and only reactive lymph nodes. Now let me share another case. This is a very special case for me. It's a case of acute juvenile arthritis not responding to conventional treatment. Every homeopath in his or her life is fortunate to treat some extraordinary cases. When I would reflect on my cases at the end of my career, this case will definitely be one of the best. This case was referred to me by a senior practitioner in Brazil after attending my lecture on polarity analysis with the other from Italy. Dear Dr. Edison, I am forever grateful to you for this case. She was consulted in the month of June and a list of symptoms was sent to her and a Skype consultation was done. What I saw and heard was shocking because the girl was walking with the help of crutches. Let us see what symptoms they had to give. She said the pain used to be worse in winter. It used to be worse when she used to wake up. Any form of movement used to aggravate the pain. In the damp weather, the pain worsened. Pressure increased it. In general, left side was more affected. She felt better in the open air. Warmth gave her relief. Covering made her better. And when she used to stretch her leg, used to feel better, and hanging limbs and rubbing helped her. When we repertorize her case, we see that single remedy that covers all the symptoms is magnesium carb. The other closest remedy was Kali carb. She gets a single dose of Mac carb, 200. And you see what happens after 1 week. She starts to walk without crutches. Then what happens after 4 months? Now she is playing football. And it is Brazil, so it has to be football. After the 1 month, she was given Mac carb every day in plussing method. After 3 months or 4 months of treatment, the parents stopped following because she was improving. And this was in the month of November that she started playing football. Now we are in April. Almost 9 months have gone and there has been no relapse and she is doing pretty well so far. Now, I'm going to share my last case for the day, and it's a case of multiple forms. This is a case of a girl whom I treated for abdominal pain with pulsatilla, and then she was asked to discontinue the treatment. She was shifted to a boarding school. There, what happened is the socks which they wear, the footwear, got exchanged, and after which she started developing these multiple painful cones. The mother says this is the only possible reason or the possible change which has happened, after which this has started. What are the symptoms? When she used to step hard, when you press her leg, it used to get worse. If you press with the hand, the pain used to be worse. When she used to wake up in the morning or on standing, the pain increased. The other rubric which I took was palms and feet soles, and I repertorized the case. Now there are two remedies which are in consideration. One is lycopodium and the other is silica. I gave her silica. One reason is she was already improving on pulsatilla. Second, silica is complementary to pulsatilla. And third, silica is known for this growth, for this palm and for this sensitivity. After 200, she was given a dose of 1 mg. In these 2 months, what happened? Her pain totally disappeared. But the cones were eschewed. That means there was no change in the cones. In the 3rd month, I gave her 1 dose of silica 10 mg. And what happened after 10 mg is, you see, there were no cones, totally gone. In polarity analysis, we begin every case with 200 potency, and if there is a substantial change in the complaints, then we go higher. That is, the next month you give 1 mg, then the another month you go to 10 mg, then you go to 50 mg, and then you go to 100 mg. And these doses need to be administered in the gap of 4 to 6 weeks. This solves the most common and generational doubt about potency which all of us face. Now the question you can ask is, why to go higher? Let us see what our master has to say in the Organon, in Aphorism 247. He says, it is impractical to repeat the same unchanged dose of the remedy once, not to mention its frequent repetition. The vital principle does not accept such unchanged doses without resistance. That is, without other symptoms of medicine to manifest themselves than those similar to the disease to be cured. Because the former dose has already accomplished the expected change in the vital principle, and a second dynamically wholly similar unchanged dose of the same medicine no longer finds therefore the same conditions of the vital. This is what is given in the Organon. And then the same aphorism continues further, and he says, but if the succeeding dose is unchanged, is changed slightly every time, namely the potenti somewhat higher, he also says that aphorism 269 and 70, then the vital principle may be altered without difficulty by the same medicine, the sensation of the natural disease diminishing, and thus the cure brought near. And that's the reason we go higher and higher. We go to 200, 1 mg, 10 mg, 50 mg, and CL. I believe if we really read Organon, we ourselves will be independent enough to treat most of the illnesses, because the Organon has all the answers. That's what we want homeopaths to do. Now comes the most important part. What is the secret to get such consistent results? The secret is accuracy. I want to share with you an information by the patient. This is patient A, and this patient shares this information about the cough. Yes, her cough has increased. It is hard to count. It is more frequent. Frequency is more. It is given twice. If I have given the medicine twice, it's a wet cough. Now you see, we don't get anything. This is not at all an accurate description of the symptoms. Now you see another patient and how nicely they describe the symptoms. He says, her head has been hurting a lot, and any pressure on the head, it hurts. The light and the heat make it worse. Cold makes it better. Appetite and thirst are fine. Lying on the left side is worse. Right side is better. And so on and so forth. Patient 1, there is no clarity at all. This patient would be difficult patient. Any approach you follow, you will find difficulty to address this patient. Whereas the second, you have good symptoms. This is what we have to do in our practice. We have to educate our patient. It is very important to educate the patient what is a symptom. In our literature, in the Organon, it is clearly mentioned that a symptom is any deviation from a former healthy state felt by the patient, marked by those around him, and observed by the physician. Again, I'm just quoting the Organon. No theory, no concept, nothing. Just plain Organon. So if the patient has a headache, he needs to observe where the pain is. What is the type of the pain? What is making it better or worse? The accuracy of description of symptoms is directly proportional to the selection of the right remedy of the patient. You see, what I see normally is patients come and say that, doctor, I have a headache. And when you go to the homeopath, just telling that you have a headache is not sufficient. Patients need to reflect on the symptoms. They have to note what makes it better and worse. He has to observe whether by touch, pressure, rubbing, sitting, standing, bending, lying, cold air, warm air, make the complaints better or worse. And after a careful thought, he has to report these findings to his homeopath. Now, to make the matters easy, what I have made is a chart of this modality, which I give to all my patients, and they have to only mark those symptoms which can increase or decrease their problem. Many patients make a mistake of marking all the options. They mark everything in this. Now, this is totally wrong. For example, there is a point which says open air improves or worsens, and they mark open air better. On asking whether open air improves the pain, they say, no, I feel better in open air, but the pain remains the same. Now, this is not a symptom. Using the checklist, this is what we call as the checklist, it reduces our time, effort in case taking, which is one of the main problems most of us face. With the use of checklists, our case taking problem in homeopathy is solved in most of the cases. And this is what you all need to educate to all your patients if you are going to use polarity analysis. And that is why I have made it mandatory in my presentation that how you have to explain to your patient what symptoms to mark, what symptoms to ignore, because your entire selection of the remedy depends on what symptoms the patient is marking. If there is any flaw in that, even one symptom is mentioned wrong, it can cause blindness. What is a symptom? A symptom is the one which is either improved or worsened by the factors that are mentioned in the checklist. Once the patients are trained to give exact symptoms, then I can tell you within 1, 2, or 3 days, you will see miraculous results. The consistency of the results improves dramatically when the patients are giving you exact symptoms. Now, what I did during the period of 2015 to 2017, I studied 304 acute cases. Criteria for successful treatment was if the patient says that I am more than 50% better within 4 days of starting the medicine, they fall into a successful criteria. Criteria for failure is no improvement or less improvement than 50% within first 4 days. And when you make the statistics, I was surprised that the success rate was 79%. And that is how my belief on this approach became stronger and stronger, and it becomes and it gets even more stronger with each passing day. I want to quote something which I came across in this book, The Inner Game of Tennis. The opponent within our head is more formidable than any other external opponent. I had my own doubts and inadequacies earlier whenever I had to encounter any case, either an acute or a chronic. This approach had given me tremendous confidence and yes, and a feeling that yes, I can do it. I can handle acute, and it is so easy. It is really very easy. In the long run, it is not what approach you follow. It is which approach gives you the confidence to deal with cases supported by objective statistical evaluation of results in your practice. So which approach to practice? Take up different approaches. Study 30 cases on each approach and make an objective statistical data and see the percentage of success and how you relate to each approach. Once you discover a particular approach is meant for you, then you keep refining it and you leave all other approaches aside. Just focus on one method, just like an eagle which has its focus on its prey. That approach will be unique individual approach for you. I can assure you that your practice will prosper and you will surely get your bread and butter. Most importantly, it will bring a sense of satisfaction. So I would suggest that you should rather, instead of going or following an approach which impresses us, we should look within and see which is the approach that suits our temperament, which suits our type of practice, and it is also to be based on statistical evaluation of results. The secret is to find what suits your core personality, individuality, essence, whatever name you call. And just as Steve Jobs said, unless you don't find what you love, keep looking, don't settle. I like this quote, that's why I'm sharing with you. This is what Bruce Lee says, I fear not the man who has practiced 10,000 kicks once, but I fear the man who has practiced one kick 10,000 times. So take up one method, one approach, one system that suits you and practice it 10,000 times and become a master of it. And as you grow wiser, you will see that all the methods, all other methods automatically fall in. The secret is still to find your calling, whether it is a matter of love, work, or even need. There are many beautiful approaches available in homeopathy. This approach suits my style of practice, my temperament. Since I had the fortune to learn directly with Dr. Heiner Freiser at his clinic in Switzerland, I wish to share this system with the homeopathic community. It will be a series of recorded webinars on polarity analysis in the month of June or July. And it consists of 4 webinars. Basically, it covers the basics of polarity analysis, how to handle acute cases, how to handle chronic cases, how to handle cases when there are too many symptoms, few symptoms, or no symptoms, understanding the meanings of the rubrics in the checklist and in the therapeutic pocketbook, and lastly, I will be available for a question answer session with the participants. Just to summarize, what we have seen today is checklist. So you give this checklist to the patient, take the exact modalities, you repertorize using the software, look for the remedy with highest polarity difference, go to the Materia Medica and finalize the remedy. I can tell you, friends, it cannot get any simpler than this. Really, this is the simplest form of homeopathy that you can ever come across, and you can get wonderful results. Lastly, these are my heroes. I look up to them every day. They see 30, 40, 50 patients a day. Polarity analysis is helping me to reach there. And I wish the same for you all, so that our divine science gets its place where it belongs. Thank you for your time. Stay home, stay safe. If you have any questions about polarity analysis, this is my email ID. And I wish you all the best. And thank you once again for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Devang. And there were a few queries, you know, from the participants, if we can address them. When do you give 200 potency? When do you escalate to 1M potency? Somebody would like to know, because they might have missed the earlier part, like what is just the gist of polarity analysis? Like what is the difference between other system and this method?
Okay. So firstly, in polarity analysis, you take the rubric using generalization, using the Bonnie-Hosen's grand generalization. So if you see that the patient's cough was better when she was lying on the left side. So when you use a Kantian approach, you take cough better by lying on the left side. Whereas when you use polarity analysis or therapeutic pocketbook, you take lying on the left side in general better. This is one aspect. Second is, I explained about how to calculate the polarity difference. The symptoms below the blue line and the symptoms below the red line. The difference between the two gives polarity difference. Third is about the contraindication. For example, the patient said that the patient is worse by lying on the line in lying position, which has one mark as far as the remedy nurse formica is concerned. The polar symptom is better by lying, which is nurse formica has four marks. So the grade 4 is greater than grade 1, and that is why the remedy is contraindicated. And the remedies which are contraindicated, what Dr. Heinefreiser says, that you don't think of these remedies. You only think of the remedies which are given in the white. You ignore the remedies which are given in the gray. And the fourth point is about potency. So what he says, and what I have kind of validated, is you start every case with 200 potency as far as the chronic case is concerned. And if the patient comes and says, okay, doctor, I have taken your medicines for 4 weeks and I'm 40%, 50% better. So when there is a substantial improvement with the remedy and there are no new complaints, then you give the same remedy in 1M potency. Okay. Now he comes for a second follow-up and he says, oh doctor, I'm 60%, 70% better. So that 30% is still yet to go. So in the subsequent follow-up, after 4 weeks or 6 weeks, you go to 10M, then you go to 50M, and then you go to CM. When the CM potency ends, you again come back to 200, provided the patient needs the same remedy. This is what the idea of polarity analysis in short. There are many aspects about contraindication, why contraindication has come up, what Bonnie-Hosen has given in the gradations, and how meticulous he was when he was grading the remedies. All this is what I explain at length in those webinars.
Thank you so much. It was indeed a wonderful session. And so friends, I hope you had a wonderful learning, a different approach and a different way which you can use not only in your acute but chronic case also to find a remedy from unbiased view. Now we do have such similar sessions coming up this week and next week. Stay tuned. On 18th of April, we have a webinar by Dr. Srikant Talari on the topic conversion of patient's language into rubric. I think that's something which would be interested for many of you. So stay tuned and do give your feedback on hope@synergyhomeopathic.com. Thank you once again to everyone. Bye. Take care.